Hello, everyone. This is Mark Plaster, Senior Executive Editor of Emergency Physicians Monthly, and you are listening to EP Talk, the place where emergency physicians and those related to our specialty come to talk about things that are real to us. And today, my guest is Dr. Tim Peck, an emergency physician, an entrepreneur, and the founder of Call 9. And Tim, welcome to the podcast, and I'm anxious to know more about you personally, as well as Call 9 and what Call 9 may mean for the future of cost savings in emergency care. But let's first talk about you. You have a fascinating, quite a pedigree, actually, to be honest with you. I noticed that you went to New York University. Is that right? NYU?
That's correct. That's correct. That's where I went to med school. Thanks for having me, Mark. I appreciate it.
And tell me, just kind of run through where you've been since medical school.
Sure. Went to medical school at NYU, went up to the Harvard Beth Israel Deaconess program for residency, did my chief year there, stayed on as faculty at the medical school, practiced in the BI system. And then early 2015, I moved, I kind of quit my academic career, moved out to Silicon Valley, joined a incubator called Y Combinator, which is kind of the leading incubator in the world for tech companies.
Well, back up. You don't jump from being an ER doc to moving to Silicon Valley. How did that happen?
Yeah, that's a good question. So my life had been part entrepreneur, part training physician for many, many years, for over a decade. I started to get involved in how technology could be useful to physicians, especially emergency physicians, to find the information that they needed quickly. How you can use search engines to be able to have tools in the emergency department and apps that have information in the emergency department just in time as you're treating patients. Now this is commonplace, and yeah. Physicians use their apps all the time on their phone. Now Google actually works for them. Now up to date is such a ubiquitous tool. At the time when I was getting interested in this, there was no real great tools out there for us, or at least they were nascent. So I started looking into that idea, raised some money around that to be able to create a product, was able to do so, formed a company, and that's where I really learned how to make a startup. That came to a very quick end once Google decided to be better at what they were doing in medicine and can use them to find information. They hadn't at the time. And so kind of pivoted off of that to look at making other applications for EMS, for emergency medicine, which all was just an education process for me. Yeah. I found myself having as many conversations I could with other entrepreneurs, with venture capitalists, with engineering and technologists, product people, started to go take classes kind of once a semester at the Harvard grad schools in entrepreneurial finance, leadership, product development, design, started to get kind of connected in with lots of design and product firms, just hunger and curiosity to know how this world worked. And that brought me out to Silicon Valley a number of times.
Okay, now stop for just a second and hold that thought, because I want to say to our listeners, how would someone access that kind of information? You were telling me about entrepreneur financing and a variety of other things like that you learned at mm-hmm. Harvard. Was that unique to you because you were a Harvard faculty, or is this something that someone who thinks they've got a better mousetrap and wants to launch it and doesn't know how to really go about it would be able to access in some fashion?
Well, the world's different than it was when I started this process 10, 12 years ago. Yeah. Now there are incubators, accelerators associated with pretty much any university in the country. And all you have to do is knock on their door and say, hey, I'd like to learn. And I'm part of your organization and one or affiliated with one way or another. Yeah. And they'll let you in. And then you can go to the talks that come through, the people who give lectures and workshops and learn about that world. If you just stop with listening to those talks, you'll never learn anything. The next step is to have that thirst and hunger, that curiosity to know more. And that means go up to that speaker, say, hey, can I buy you a cup of coffee? And that leads from to another conversation, to another conversation, to be pointed toward one of the, you know, the key books that, you know, there's a dozen, two dozen books maybe out there that can, if you read them, you can, you know, give yourself all the information you need about how all this works, the TED Talks, etc. And you just start consuming information and forming, becoming a self-made man or woman.
So jumping back to your story, you went to Silicon Valley, you launched these products, and then Google kind of caught up, and then what happened?
Yeah, so I was kind of flying back and forth to Silicon Valley even when I was in residency, which was any time I had off, I would get on a plane and go out there and follow any leads I had or people I wanted to meet. Met my person who eventually became the CTO and co-founder of Call 9 with me, etc. And then there's this incubator, a place that allows companies to, as fledgling companies, to grow and learn, called Y Combinator. It Airbnb, Dropbox, Reddit, Zenefits, House, which is one of the big companies that came out of there recently. All these enormous startups all got their start there, but they hadn't done health tech. Okay. And so I pitched them with some others the idea of a health tech company being part of, you know, one of their first companies there, and they took us in. I learned so much from them, and one of the things I really learned from them was about how to make something people want, and how to make a really amazing product that people desire, and then how to build a business model around that. And one of the ways to do that, and there's another company that I've learned a lot from called innovation company called IDEO, I-D-E-O, which if you want to get into a rabbit hole on the internet, I suggest looking into IDEO, what they do. It's about user research, what they call human-centered design, and going to the user to learn as much about them as possible so you can build something around them rather than make a business model and then figure out a product. It's about figuring out a product and service and making a business model instead.
And you did something very, very, very unusual in what I've heard when you were looking at taking care of elderly patients from nursing homes. We all emergency physicians think we kind of know everything there is to know about transfers from nursing homes to emergency departments and how so many of those are useless, yada, yada, yada. We all know that, right? But you did something that was very unusual that was kind of a reflection of what you just said. Why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, I think it starts with realizing I have a very convicted that there is not many people problems in this world, but systems problems, and that people who have issues or anger or complaints or bad experiences really stems around that the system doesn't work. And if you have to really get down to what's going on with the system itself to understand about solving problems. And the problem that I started to get really obsessed with and almost angry about and disappointed with was the experience of these unnecessary transfers from nursing homes in the emergency department. Yeah. And as I started to step back and look at, you know, macro trends, you look at the numbers of EMS transfers, and 19% of those transfers that go to the hospital originate from nursing homes and rehabs.
From a guy who spent 25 years working at night, okay, I can tell you that it's another patient, you know, transfer from the nursing home. I lived what you're talking about. I was the other end of that. And so, so in order to really understand that, you moved into a nursing home. Is that
right? That's correct. It's a black box, right? As an emergency physician, you've never been in a nursing home. You may have been in there to visit a family member, but it hasn't been part of your medical training.
Right.
You're not going to a nursing home to see what's actually happening in there. And so you have so many preconceived notions of why this patient was sent to you. And it's usually this frustration of, why is this patient here?
That's right. Actually, to be honest with you, I actually started my medical career as a nurse's aide in a nursing home. So I actually...
Well, you're the exception.
I'm the exception there. So when you started talking about this, I said, I know exactly what he's talking about. I know the person he's talking about.
Yeah, so I didn't know anything about nursing homes. I really didn't. And that was a big revelation to say, oh, wow, I don't actually know how to solve this problem.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even know how to begin. So I went and lived in a nursing home for 3 months.
Get that? Hey, everybody, listen to this. This guy went and lived in a nursing home for 3 months. Holy moly. Oh, and so what did you find out from there?
So I had the patient experience and I was doing that, but I was also eventually lived in and moved into the conference room, had a cot there, and yeah, just started to learn about all the different people who worked there, the processes, yeah, how the finances worked, et cetera. And what I learned is, again, macro level, there's about 1.3 million transfers to the emergency department. CMS looks at this and says that 2/3 of those are avoidable. They look at those patients who are admitted, and you and I know that 70-80% of these patients are admitted to the hospital. Once they get to us, they said 45% of those are avoidable when they look at discharge paperwork and their codes that they were coded with, and said, there must be a better way. Well, what is the better way? What's the problem that we're even trying to solve on the ground? And it came down to three things in these nursing homes. And a lot of this is shocking even to an emergency physician. The first is labs and diagnostics. They don't exist in nursing homes. And if they do, they have to call out for them.
Exactly.
Yeah, the nurses don't know how to draw blood or give IVs. That's not a core skill set for them, for most of them at least. And so you have to call a service, and a service will come maybe 24 or 48 hours later, and the results will come back 24 or 48 hours later. So you have an INR of 10, and you're waiting for that INR.
Right.
Someone fell. And you want to take an INR and then see where it is. And they didn't hit their head, but maybe you're worried.
Yeah.
You have to wait 72 hours to know that their blood is super thin. So that's the kind of thing. You can't make a medical decision that way.
Yeah.
And then so the question is, who's making the medical decision? Well, there's no doctors in nursing homes.
Right.
Doctors aren't in nursing homes. There's a few of the 15,600 nursing homes, but 99% of them don't have doctors. Instead, they deal with primary care doctors who are in the community, who have a patient panel of 20 patients that day. And if they get a call from the nursing home saying, hey, 80-year-old female is having shortness of breath, what are they going to do? They can't come over there. They have 20 other patients. Not only that, nights, holidays, weekends, they're not working. And they get it. If they are on call, they get a call and say, hey, I can't come in. I got to go to work tomorrow. So send this patient to the hospital. And that's how that works.
Yeah,
In
some cases, I was actually, not too long ago, got presented the opportunity to actually purchase a nursing home. It's a longer story, but the point was, one of the things I looked at was becoming the doctor for the nursing home. And I realized that there were two layers between the patient, actually three layers between the patient and a doctor anytime there was a question. And first there was the home health aide who was there, who was taking care of their physical custodial needs and was the only person there at night, who then when they had a problem, they called a nurse who was not on site, who was a nurse for multiple hospitals, who then invariably punted it to the doctor or punted it directly to the ER. Most of the time, those calls never actually got to the physician who was supposed to be caring for those patients. And instead, it was a reflex. We can't take the liability of making any kind of a judgment decision on this patient. And next thing you know, you've got an ambulance out in front of the nursing home. And so,
and again, that's a systems problem, right? And And whenever anyone says we can't take the liability, it's because they don't have the tools to take the liability, right, or they're not empowered to take that liability because the way that the system is set up doesn't have faith in them. So how do you fix that? And that's really the third part, is that the nursing to patient ratio in a nursing home across the country is one nurse, and that's LPNs and RNs, to 36 patients.
Right, right.
That's, you have one patient who's sick, how is that nurse ever going to take care of those other?
Right, and I want to emphasize the LPN, licensed practical nurse, many of them not qualified to make any clinical judgments whatsoever. Even the RNs, most often, is not on site more than a few hours a day at most, maybe just on call. And anyway, so...
And if they're taking care of the whole house. They're not just taking care of that one sick patient. But
So what did you decide to do with call 9? What was call 9's response to that?
Yeah, so we combated those three problems, went right after them. So we put diagnostics in the nursing home as cheaply as we could with bedside labs from an iStat machine. Many of us have used those and results within a couple minutes, and a coag check and a glucometer. We put real-time ultrasound in the nursing home, where a physician who's at home can do ultrasound on a patient with the hands of the nurse. And we put a stethoscope, and we put urinalysis, EKGs, telemetry, put all of this on a single cart. And so you can wheel this into a patient to get this information. Now, we also, those nurses are busy, so we supplemented that with a paramedic in each nursing home. And that was the extra person who would work there.
Your model was that the paramedic would work there all the time, or that the paramedic would respond to a call?
Depending on the size of it, they would work there all the time. I mean, there are some nursing homes. As long as they had about 200 beds or more, which is a good portion of the nursing homes out there, that would work. Some of the smaller nursing homes that had mostly very acute patients, also that works because there's plenty of volume and plenty to do. We also, any slack that those, there was a lot of operational efficiencies in which, say, a paramedic in one nursing home where it was slow would be doing work for another nursing home, kind of the back end work and the notes and the things like that. So you can spread, with scale, you can spread a lot of these functions out.
Sure.
And make it feasible. That kind of model doesn't work when you're only doing one nursing home necessarily, but it could. There are ways. So you had this paramedic, we called them a clinical care specialist. They went to the bedside whenever there was any type of acute need. They tapped an app on an iPhone or an Android device and connect to an emergency physician who is home, remote, 24/7, always available to the patient, sitting in their home on their own laptop. And that physician could see multiple patients at once in multiple nursing homes, irregardless of geography, and jump from a nursing home A to B and back to A in parallel fashion, which a lot of telemedicine is not capable of doing, especially at the time when we started. Most of it is serial. And that allowed to make a remote emergency department where you were treating multiple patients at once.
Hey.
We started to add in mid-levels that could help. And you'd see patients over the course of a shift and manage a whole panel of patients. Sure. It didn't matter that they weren't in the same place.
And that was the technology part of it that you put together. You pulled in people to help you put together that platform.
That's right. So I myself had learned a lot of what's called product development over that last decade before we had started this, and kind of ran product at first, which means the person who kind of serves as a organizer and communicator between the engineering team, the coders, the people who make the technology, and the users themselves to try to figure out how to make the best product possible. So that was a large piece of what I was doing. And yes, had a CTO, chief technology officer, and eventually a team of 15 engineers, data scientists, and product and designers.
Well, you know, all the emergency physicians listening to this can say that sounds perfect. Sounds like the perfect situation. Better care. Sign me up. I want to do this kind of stuff because it will provide better care. You also saved the insurers a tremendous amount of money by run through some of the numbers you and I have talked about, and some of those numbers are in the piece that I put into EPM. But I think I got some of the numbers wrong, and you corrected me.
Yeah. So. And we know these numbers very well because we had contracts with 9 different insurance companies. And so once you do get into contract with them, you can see their numbers on how much these patients are actually costing. And so every hospitalization that would occur, not just the ED transfer, but the hospitalization in one of these patients who are generally very sick, very fragile, have multiple comorbidities, some of them have 15, 20 comorbidities. Especially the dual eligibles, meaning the Medicare, Medicaid patients, would cost upwards of $20,000 on average, these populations, for hospitalization to them. The low end of that was around 15, the high end was around 20,000, depending on the insurer. And that goes for Medicare as well. So you, when you add all the costs up and what was being spent across the country, it came out to somewhere, depending on who was doing the math, somewhere between $20 and $40 billion.
Billion with a B.
Billion. That's
staggering. But that would be staggering to the average person. It's certainly to a legislator. Not so staggering to you and I, because we realize how much these things cost. And the idea of being able to cut into that figure. Okay, you're not going to make it go away, obviously. Mm-hmm. But you're going to cut into that figure. How much do you think, or how much did your research show that a system like Call 9 could cut into that or reduce that $20 to $40 billion figure? What's realistic? Not pie in the sky. What's realistic to be able to cut that number to?
So we did our own research, and that's good. And lots of abstracts out there that I can share with you and your readers. That showed reductions of hospitalization rates of 30, 40, 50% at times, which, you know, 50% of 1.3 million transfers times $20,000 is in the billions. The thing that we did is we knew what we did was working so well, and there had never been really a program that showed any type of significant reduction of hospitalizations beyond the teens of percentages. And again, it was their own research. What we did is we handed over our data blindly to a group at Harvard and West Health, which is a large not-for-profit geriatric institute, and said, here, open book, take a look at it. Whatever you find, you find. We had to agree that they would publish it no matter if it was good or bad results for Call 9. And it is not out yet, but the manuscript is written and the preliminary results are out. So not sure I could share all of it yet, but I can, and it's not completely, hasn't been reviewed by the journal yet that it'll be published in completely, and all their results back, all the comments back. But essentially what it did was looked at a matched group of 2,300 patients in one group, which is 2,300 patients that we saw sequentially, and then 2,300 patients that emergency department saw that had the same diagnoses, et cetera, that were matched pretty well. And so 73% of the patients that we saw stayed in the nursing home during this time. And then in the emergency department group, 71% were admitted. So essentially,
talking to the choir, you know, but, we know that we know those numbers are true. Yeah. Okay. I want to move on though, because the catastrophe here is this is so obvious. This is as obvious as a nose in your face that you're going to save the payers billions of dollars. And yet call 9 failed. And I'm not going to dig into this because I know that's painful. It has to be more than one of the most painful things that's ever happened to you. You raised $30 million from investors who looked at what you're doing and said, this is obvious. This is a no-brainer. This is going to make a lot of money. And it failed, and you ended up closing your doors. I want to dissect why. Why did that happen?
Yeah. We raised into equity, which is, you know, when you sell pieces of your business, we raised about $36 million. And then a few more was raised in what's not called debt. So, yeah, we had about $40 million spent, and we spent it on developing the product, treating these patients. And we did that 6 years before there was any infrastructure to get paid. Right. So
you worked for nothing for 6 years.
For 3 years until we started to get paid, but it wasn't quite enough at first, especially to get paid to cover the bills completely. And that's okay in one way. It's what investors do. They find something that works, put money into it to try to develop a business model around it before anybody else does and see what we can make together. And what we made was something great, but the changes that needed to happen in healthcare payment models happened slowly, but we were responsible for those changes. We were the ones pushing on it. So, yeah. So did a lot of work and spent a lot of money on lobbyists, on lawyers, on...
Well, let's talk about the Rush Act. People. You know, I want to... Because basically what you're saying is that you ran out of money... And we won't get into the business aspect of this so much because I think that physicians kind of are interested in seeing this succeed instead of dissecting why it failed. So what you determined is that Medicare and the government, being the largest payer, did not have the legislative structure, the financial structure, to actually pay for the savings or to share the savings. It's like we'll pay you for the care, but if you save us money, even if you save us $20 billion, there's no mechanism currently to actually share any portion of that, except in the ACO model. We all know that the family doctors, when they're given these big panels in an ACO, if they're able to lower the cost, the expenditures of that group, then they get like 3-4 a tiny percent. They might reduce the utilization of that group half by 50%. I'm just picking a number out of the air, but they might reduce utilization by 50% and get 4% or 3% of the savings. It didn't make any sense, but there's no mechanism. At least when you started, there was no mechanism for sharing these kinds of savings.
Let me also say, it wasn't only sharing the savings, it was actually even being paid for what we were doing. We could get paid for doing stuff as long as we did the stuff that was on the Medicare fee-for-service schedule.
Right.
But what we were doing was so outside of the box and innovative that there were no codes for us to use. And theirs is very clear that you have to bill for what you do, not what you can get paid for. Right. If you do something and Medicare says you have to tell us what you did, you have to bill for that. So we were doing critical care in nursing homes with emergency physicians over telemedicine across state lines. It was just well beyond what they had ever imagined or had infrastructure for.
But since the idea worked, you got the Rush Act. Tell me about the Rush Act, the cardinal elements of the Rush Act, which Rush stands for.
Reducing unnecessary senior hospitalizations.
There you go.
Great name. Wasn't my idea on the name. I wish it was. It was a staffer from the Republican Party, actually, who came up with that. But it was a very bipartisan bill. And it was wonderful to watch people working together from both sides of the aisle. And it was sponsored. The bill was sponsored by leading Republicans and Democrats from both sides of the aisle. It was introduced in 2018. What the Rush Act did was created a payment model and a system that would acknowledge programs like Call 9, not exactly like Call 9, would incorporate others as well, that would then say at the end of the day, there's savings, 37.5% of those savings would go to the physician group, and 12.5% would go to the nursing home. Medicare would keep the other 50%. As you said, that's very different than the ACO model, right? Or where you're getting a small bonus for what you're doing. The reason is the average cost of these patients was so extraordinary and so high, that the savings were so high, that the way a bill gets passed, that one of these healthcare bills gets passed, is it has to get scored by something called the Congressional Budget Office.
Yep, CBO. And the CBO scoring.
Yep, CBO scoring. You hear that a lot in the news. And so what a CBO score does is says, this is going to cost us money, or this is going to save us money as a society, as a tax, as a the budget of the country. And the way that this was set up, it was going to save. It's going to be scored in a way that, that saves a lot of money, right? There's no way for it to not. And then not only that, just to even guarantee it, there were these budget neutrality clauses in it to make it so that the score would at least be $0, neither negative or positive. That's where they were starting. So it was very exciting, and it was being used as a way for these legislators to create what they call tip of the spear bill, meaning the first way of getting a shared savings model through a legislative way into CMS using a CBO score that would work. Because in the past, and this is the problem for telemedicine, CBO scores are always positive, not negative, not saving. They're always
it's
meant for telemedicine.
Right, right.
And the reason they say it costs is because it says telemedicine is duplicative.
Yeah, yeah. Right? They're basically saying that, you know, telemedicine is going to cost us more because people will use it more. Utilization will go up, even if you could try to make the case that they will not end up in the ER. It's harder to do than you can. You can actually see the numbers. Without it, they go to the ER. With it, they don't go to the ER. What's the financial difference? CBO could score that in their sleep and show that that's worth billions of dollars.
That's right. And so the one of the things is, where's the evidence? Where's the proof? We handed over all of our data.
Yeah.
Other companies we were working with were going to do the same. We had done a lot of academic studies on our own, but we were waiting for this Harvard West Health study that I mentioned earlier to come out. And it's coming out now. So once that's published, that now becomes the gold standard of what's here, becomes validated by a lot of parties. And we'll go back at the Rush Act at that point.
Okay.
Because the CBO, it's just that a lot of these people are still in power and in office. Others have left or have been removed or lost their races or retired. But many of them are still the highest leaders in the House and Senate who believe in this and want this to happen.
Well, you know, it's a disruptive idea. And if there's nothing more we can say about what's going on in politics right now, it's disruptive. People are ready for trying some big changes. And I without getting into the fight that's going on in Washington right now, the truth be told is that people are, for the first time, really looking at not nibbling around the edges, but looking at sometimes wholesale changes in major programs, whether it's Medicare for all or whether it's major changes like this, looking at using market forces and innovation to reduce costs. Everybody knows that if there's one thing that I can say that will happen in the 2020 legislature, whether a Republican or a Democrat is in office or who has the control of the House of Representatives, one of the major issues that will be discussed will be the cost of healthcare. It's too high. We all know it's too high. And the question is going to be, how are we going to attack it? And it's ironic, not ironic. It's something I've been saying literally for 20 years, is that the people who are probably best able to see and affect that cost are people with broad experience, maybe not, you know, and that is emergency physicians. You know, we understand the breadth of care. We may not know beyond the first 48 hours. Maybe we do. But the point of it is that we know access to healthcare. That's what this whole specialty was built on, was a new model that looked at access to healthcare. And when we look at the kinds of things that Call 9 was doing, we all look at it and say, okay, we just didn't have the tools before. We didn't have remote labs. We didn't have remote technology that could connect a learned provider, an expert, a board certified emergency physician with a patient in a nursing home. But now we do. We've got that capability. And there is no reason we need to be spending the kind of money that we do just blindly. And so I just, I looked at Call 9 and I looked at what you did and I said, you've got to take another swing at this. You absolutely have. You know, you got $30 million, maybe you need $300 million. Maybe you needed more money. We need to get people on board with this idea, because this is a concept that absolutely is strong, very strong. Yep.
So the you know, what I'm doing now, helping a lot of other companies right now with what I've learned and advising for companies and sitting on boards, et cetera. And that's a great thing, while also getting some of the other financial pieces into place for Call 9 Generation 2 to happen. It will require money, but the money will go so much further with all the lessons that we learned.
You're not starting from scratch. You have a foundation of an organization that literally worked. You just need to get paid for it.
Yeah. Yep. And the payments, you know, they are there through ACOs. There's something called direct contracting that PCPs are going to have access to in a year coming through, which is pretty amazing. There's something called ISNPs, which are institutional special needs plans. Those are Medicare Advantage plans for nursing homes. There are ways to get paid immediately. If you are willing to take the risk on yourself, and with these results, there's no reason not to take the risk on yourself. And that's there. I want to add one thing to your thoughts there, Mark. I think you're right that emergency physicians understand the whole breath. They understand the first 48 hours, but they also understand, as you said, the access to healthcare. And one thing that we as an industry can do is realize that access does not have to be in the buildings that we've traditionally worked in.
Yeah.
They do not have to be in the emergency department. We can access, with technology, access those patients and have them enter the system into our specialty. We could still be the ones in control of this, the ones who are leading the future of how patients access healthcare, by going to them and figuring out ways that we can do that in a different way. The walls of an emergency department are very artificial. And if we could think outside those walls, the emergency medicine community can continue to be leaders in helping people access healthcare.
Absolutely. I want to finish this up with a brief reference to something that was you spoke about in the previous podcast I listened to, and it had to do with communication with patients and families, and how that one of the things we do know is that elderly patients don't want to go to the hospital if they don't absolutely have to go to the hospital. And family members, when we communicate with family members, oftentimes would like to see them treated in a place that they are comfortable, that's their space. It's very disorienting and fear and bringing about fear in elderly patients when we scoop them up, put them in the back of an ambulance, lights and sirens, bring them to the ER. I mean, I have elderly parents who live with me, and I can guarantee you they do not want to go to the hospital. They do not. And when this kind of a technology, this kind of a system change occurs, it's very reassuring. You're communicating with, when you can, communicating with patients and families and allowing them to say, no, I think we won't go to the hospital. We'll treat mom where we are. If there's communication there between knowledgeable providers, and I underscore knowledgeable providers, and family members and staff, a lot of these patients, even when they truly are sick, maybe even life-threatening, if they make the decision that, no, I'm not going to reflexively go to the ER, go to the hospital, they feel better about it. They're involved. And so I think that one of the things that you spoke about with Call 9 that really empowers patients is to say, okay, I've got the information that I need, and maybe I don't want to go to the hospital. Maybe I want to just be treated here where I'm at. And I think that's invaluable.
I think that was an amazing part of what can happen. I'd also add in that an emergency physicians, I think, are thinking more and more like this recently. It's not only about aggressively treating them, but also providing a place where people don't have to go to the hospital to die.
Yeah.
If it's the end of your life, the last place you want to be is in an ambulance.
Yeah.
The last place we all know. We know the last place that we want our patients to be is in the emergency department.
Yeah.
And we don't even want to send them upstairs. We want to get them home. The case management and the system just doesn't support it all the time. So helping people make more beautiful experiences in their home or where they live to die as well as to thrive and live is important. And I think that's we had a robust palliative care program as well. That was just had to be part of it.
Yeah. Well, Tim, thanks so much for joining us here at EP Talk. And to our listeners, there will be, if you may say, in 1,200 words, I can't really capture what Tim's talking about here, but they hopefully laid the groundwork for you to understand more closely or more expansively, shall I say, what Tim and Call 9 are doing with healthcare. And I, when I'm at ASAP, I constantly hear people talking about these system ideas, and Tim's the kind of guy who just took the bull by the horns and actually did it. I would recommend you follow his footsteps. There's a lot of things, as I said in the piece, that if we really those of us who understand healthcare had the opportunity to start reshaping how it's costing, it'd be like Edward Scissorhands going at the healthcare cost. I think that we could cut the amount of fat off of this system knowledgeably, while improving care and improving the patient experience. So I encourage you to follow Tim Peck's footsteps. They're big footsteps, I have to say. And he's done an amazing thing here, but he's a trailblazer, and I would hope that we would be following him in a lot of different areas, not just this one. But thanks, Tim. I appreciate you joining us here at EP Talk. And for our listeners, I hope you enjoyed this, and keep listening to EP Talk. Thank you.